Survey Report, SS Liberty. We, the undersigned, held survey this date on the above-named vessel while it is floating in one of the docks of the Harland and Wolff shipyard in Northern Ireland, with the objective of knowing the nature, importance and the necessary repairs of the damages occurred in the above-mentioned ship as a consequence of the attack of several German torpedo plane fighters Messerschmitt Bf 109 and incendiary bombers Heinkel He 111 in the English Channel, with torpedo impact in the stern causing an explosion as well as a fire in the bow and firing in several deck equipment on December 15. The following damage was found in the course of investigations into the ship. 1. Damage to the steering system. Due to the impact of the torpedo on the stern, the explosion caused damage to a great extent in the stern frame area, therefore this damage can be translated into the volatilization of the rudder as well as the breakage of the rudder stock. In addition, due to the shock wave, the violence of the explosion resulted in part of the rudder coming off the pintle. The strakes around the stern were bent and finally the transmission of energy to the upper zone of the rudder stock caused the steering gears to move out of position and therefore the hydraulic system actuators could not do their work properly, leaving the ship without any control. 2. Damage to the propeller and propeller shaft. The explosion resulted in the loss of the propeller boss and two of the four propeller blades. The breakage of the blades was due to the fact that when the explosion occurred, the blades were still spinning and therefore, some parts of the propeller boss hit the blades, leaving them in an out-of-service situation. In addition to this, there was a 2 meters stern opening in the fairing plate, which was due to the fact that when the explosion occurred, the propeller together with its own shaft was displaced sideways by the vibration causing the welding and rivets of the stern post to fail. Therefore, in addition to displacing the propeller shaft, it also displaced its bearings and finally, due to the torsion moments, it also cracked the shaft itself. The after peak compartment collapsed at several points, so even although the breach was narrower than the main one, water still managed to enter the shaft tunnel compartment until it reached retention compartment number 4. This last bulkhead had the watertight doors activated and the pumps in that area were able to prevent the water from spreading to the cofferdam in the engine room and as a result leaving the ship partially controlled in terms of buoyancy in the stern area. 3. Damage to load, unload equipment and deck. Another problem was the impact of different projectiles on the surface of the main deck. During the attack, the planes descended vertically while firing their projectiles to try to reach the holds loaded with ammunition and equipment for the Allies. Therefore, during the descent of one of these planes, several impacts were against the longitudinal coaming of the starboard cargo hatch number 2. Leaving not very important damages as well as damaging also several hatch beams that cover the hatch opening. A second pass of the fighters caused damage to the horizontal coaming of the hatches and soon after, more significant damage to the air intakes of the side ventilation systems. Several of these impacts damaged the engines of the winches of the number 2 cargo mast, leaving them unable to lift or descend cargo. As this type of ship has a loading and unloading system that works with two derricks using the so-called union purchase method, the breakage of one of the mast's derricks, particularly the port one, leaves the hold without any capacity of maneuvering the cargo. 4. Damage to number 1 hold. At the same time that the deck was shot by the fighters, the bombers passed at a higher altitude and released their cargo into the ships. When the bombs were dropped, one of these hit the SS Liberty in the bow area, passing through the number 1 cargo hatch cover with relative ease reaching the inside of the forward hold. Thanks to the fact that there was no ammunition in that hold, there was no explosion, but a fire occurred due to the nature of the bomb that the crew took a long time to suffocate. It is necessary to point out that steel for shipbuilding has a temperature limit of 538 degrees and once this is exceeded, over time the steel begins to lose resistance qualities, to contract and to bend, deforming the surface of the hull. During the time that the fire was active, a series of damages were produced in different parts of the structure, among them the fore bulkhead was notably damaged and slightly the aft bulkhead of the hold. When the bomb fell to port, it caused serious deformations in frames number 12 to 20, side stringer and web frames 5 and 6, in addition to this the inner bottom plate, bottom girders 5 to 7, and floor plates 10 to 15 were deformed, weakening to a great extent the structure on the port side of the ship. Due to the action of the crew, the fire could be suffocated in time so that the stresses generated in the bottom plates did not generate a collapse and therefore a flood. As a conclusion to this case, during the return trip to be repaired, there was not bad weather, so it meant that the damaged plates were not subjected to the efforts of moments of hogging and sagging when the ship is in different positions in the wave, and that they could perfectly have splitted in two, as in many other cases has happened. General recommendations. The situation of the ship has been studied and the repair procedures should be followed as follows. Firstly, it is considered necessary to use divers to temporarily fix the water opening produced in stern, and then with the help of mechanical pumps, pump the shaft stern and tunnel compartment to release the water on board. It is then necessary to remove the ship, considering that support tugs will be needed as the ship is not able to move by its own means of propulsion. In addition to this, the cradle in the dry dock should be conditioned with the necessary equipment for the stranding of the vessel and guarantee its integrity. Once the ship is secured, the broken shaft must be removed, as well as the propeller, the bearings and the corresponding plates that constitute the after peak bulkheads and the bulkhead that separates this from the shaft tunnel. Other factors that the stern joint plates have to be replaced to make it watertight again should be taken into account. Besides, it must be remembered that the old sternpost heel has to be replaced in order to install the new one, and the remains of the rudder stock that have been destroyed have to be removed in order to install a new stock in the servomotor and check that the hydraulic system is operational again and therefore the paddle responds to the orders from the wheelhouse. Next, the loading derrick system must be repaired, that is, the winch of the port derrick must be replaced, as well as the working motor. On the other hand, the combings and hatch beams of the number 2 hatch cover on the starboard side have to be replaced. Another problem to be solved would be the disassembly of the damaged elements in the cargo hold number 1 due to the fire caused during the attack, and again implement the corresponding web frames, side stringers, floor plates, inner bottom plates, bottom girders and frames. Finally, it would be necessary to remark that the internal and external repairs are successfully carried out in the dry dock and in the navigation, and in this way check the correct operation of the servomotor, the aft collision bulkhead and the shaft, the cargo hold bulkheads, and the repair of all the parts affected by the fire in the hold. As a last note, remove all possible parts left over from the repair and clean the rubble so that the ship is ready to be serviced again. Due to the current wartime situation, the need for supply ships in the southern parts of England and France from the Allied ships, and the distance from the United States of Great Britain makes it impractical to bring them back, so the repairs will be in Northern Ireland with a narrow period of 12 days. We estimate and agree that the costs of the repair to be carried out by the state with the intervention of the United States will be around $260,000. Thank you so much for watching. See you in the next video.